Robert Craighead. Everybody, look who we have on the show, mate. It is a pleasure to have you on. It's an honor. How are you, mate? Thanks for coming on.
Fandiddly fantastic. Happy Ragnarok, everybody.
How can I ever get sick of that voice, Rob? Honestly. You are the greatest blacksmith of all time. You know that, don't you?
Oh, well, thank you. Well, I mean, I get an argument from my brother, but, you know, who listens to him?
Sorry, Adam, but Rob's got this one. mate, we were just talking. How have you been? Because I know there's strikes going on and everything, but how are you keeping busy?
Oh, well, fortunately, I went to Atlanta and just wrapped up on season 5 of a television series I do there for Tyler Perry called Ruthless. It's on BET Plus. And we got that in under the wire, and all the episodes were written in advance. And thank goodness right now there's never been anything's never really been worked out in regards to these streaming networks like Hulu and Netflix. And I mean, there's a million of them now. And I'm on one now, but on Hulu, I was on Future Man for Seth Rogen and for a couple of years. And it's just, they're not equal to what primetime network television shows pay as far as what they're paying the actors, what they're paying in residuals, et cetera. And it's difficult to get your insurance. It's difficult to make a living. There are no residuals, so to speak. So, it's time to renegotiate, and let's try and make this thing a little bit more realistic and not just the big corporations making billions, you know.
How is video game pay evolved? I'm curious. You don't have to go into details, obviously, but has that gotten better over the years as well?
For me, yeah.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, from the first one to now, yeah, it's considerably better. You get a couple of hits under your belt. And I think actually video games, the amount of money they make, like I think Sony actually makes more money off of video games, Sony PlayStation, than it does actually films in making movies or television shows. So
I think I read somewhere, yeah, God of War has already sold millions and millions of units in the first week, Ragnarok. So who knows what it's at now?
Oh yeah, I have no idea. I know that they're doing well. They're doing well over there at Sony PlayStation.
Yeah, they're leading the race. Hey? So what do you think of streaming platforms, by the way? What's the general consensus with actors that you know? What do they think about it? Is this a sustainable model, do you think?
Absolutely. I think it's already proven that it's sustainable. Yeah. I mean, it's only gotten more and more evolved. And, I have also DirecTV. That's because I'm an avid NFL fan. So I have to watch my NFL football games on Sunday, and the only way you can do that really, well, now I'm learning that there's other options available to me, but yeah, so I've got DirecTV, then I've got Netflix, then I've got Hulu, then I've got HBO Max, and you know, it's you're paying out the wazoo for everything, but so let's play the actors, you know.
Exactly. Who do you go for in the NFL?
I'm an avid Dallas Cowboys fan. I've been a diehard. It's been a rough 26 years, but
yeah. Is it? Is there something around the corner, do you think?
Oh, I think this year is our year. It's our year, absolutely. My wife says this is the best time of year for a Dallas Cowboy fan because there's so much optimism and hope, and you know, because You know, we're in training. We're just about to start training
camp. Yeah, so. Yeah.
Hey, I've watched some of that Aussie football.
AFL, yeah.
What is it?
AFL, Aussie Rules Football. What do you think?
Aussie Rules Football. Man, that's amazing. There's like some kind of a play where they jump up on top of a guy's shoulders.
It's called a specky.
What?
A specky. It's called a specky. Yeah, you essentially jump on their back and mark the ball. Yeah. It's happened to me. It's not fun. Trust me, Rob.
It looks
having a knee right in your back. Yeah. there's no protective gear in AFL or rugby down here. So maybe we're just a bit dumb in the end.
No. It looks exciting. It looks very exciting. I've watched it a few times. I've worked with several actors from Australia, even, I mean, God of War, even, you know, we have an Aussie on there, you know.
Ben
Pendergrass.
He was a very integral part of this game, which we will touch on.
Fantastic. But,
did you grow up in Dallas, or where did you grow up?
I grew up in Texas. I grew up in a little town about 150 miles north of Dallas called Electra. It's about 2,500 people. Sounds a lot more glamorous than it actually is. Electra. From Electra.
Yeah.
But I love it. Electra. I love my hometown. I love all the people there. And I go back. I've still got my brother and sister there. My parents have passed on now, but you know, I've got all my family back there, and I go there every year at least a couple of times, and it's always fun. Yeah. Get back to your roots, you know.
When did you move out of there?
Dallas Cowboys there, then you're in trouble, you know.
I mean, yeah, I can imagine. When did you move from there? And was acting always something that you wanted to pursue, or did it fall into your lap, or how did you come across it? Because I know everyone's story is different.
Yeah, I know. I mean, so there have been some people that it has fallen into their lap. And, you know, God bless them. I mean, I wish it had happened that way for me. But
yeah,
I'm a success after, 40 years or something like that. No, I was pretty fortunate, I think. I grew up wanting to be an actor in this little town in Texas, watching old movies with my mom late at night. And, you know, I just wanted to get out to Hollywood and make movies. So when I was 18 years old, you know, I came out to Hollywood and I went to acting school at the American Academy of Dramatic Arts and did their program there, learned how to do it right. You know, the training is impeccable. It's 8 hours a day. You know, voice, dance, you know, acting, and just everything all encompassed, movement. And that's how I got out here. Once I got out of acting school, I was very fortunate and started working fairly quickly. I mean, it's, so I guess I was lucky. I guess it kind of fell in my lap like that, maybe, but not an overnight success.
No. And what age were you then when you booked your first gig? Big gig, TV, movie?
It wasn't big. No, my first gig was just a little part, but it was on a show called Cagney and Lacey, and with Tyne Daly and Meg Foster and... anyway, I just had a small part, and that got me into the union, and took off from there. My first movie was a movie called Return of the Living Dead. If you're a horror movie fan, it's quite a cult classic.
Yeah. Were you nervous on that set, or excited, or do you remember the feelings?
Oh yeah, no, I've never. I don't get nervous. It's because it's what I love to do. I have such a passion in my heart for it that, you know, it's exciting for me, but I don't think I get nervous. No,
No. And when did the rumblings of video game work come into your world and where this was going to be a viable option for actors to do motion capture and voice work in games? Because I know your first game, was it Tomb Raider, if I'm not mistaken?
No, my first game was, it was also for Sony PlayStation. It was called Resistance,
Burning Skies. Yeah. Wow.
It was some handheld little game.
Yeah, Vita game. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I've never seen it.
Yeah, I've played it. I've beaten it. Yeah. I don't remember what character you were, though. It has been
Colonel 11 years. Colonel Amherst.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Some bald-headed guy, or General Amherst or Colonel Amherst, something like that. It was military. But yeah, zombies everywhere and whatever. Isn't that right?
Yeah. So that was just voice, obviously.
No, that was motion capture as well. And I did that down in San Diego. It was before actors started doing a lot of motion capture. And I got the offer and went down to San Diego and did it. And I was there for a couple of days, wrapped it up and got back here. And I get the next job I did was Tomb Raider. Yeah.
And Tomb Raider was mocap as well? Performance capture?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Yeah.
That was pretty elaborate. That was my first, you know, Burning Skies was not that, you know, I wasn't involved that much. And it was kind of for some new type of device, the Vita, whatever you called it. But no, Tomb Raider was Camilla Luddington played. Yeah, from Grey's Anatomy. She's from the UK. She was, this was before Grey's Anatomy. She was Laura Croft. A lot of great Robin Atkins Downs. A lot of great actors in that. And I was very fortunate to play the main villain, Father.
Yeah, Mathias. I was going to say.
Yeah.
Great performance. Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you. You played it, huh?
I've played everything you're in, Rob. Come on. I have to do my research. No, I really enjoyed Tomb Raider. A really great game. What do you remember about that, Rob? I'm curious. Was it because that's your first bigger title and you're new to the video game world? This is before God of War, I'm guessing, before you even got that role.
Right. Well, Corey Barlog had just taken over as, I guess, the head of Sony Santa Monica Studios. And so I met him. Toby, I think name's Toby Gard, I believe, is who directed it. He was an Englishman. It was a new experience for me, really. But it took me back to my very first early acting lessons, acting 101, because you have to visualize, you know, everything around you, you know, your set, you know, your costumes, your props, everything is, nothing's there. So you have to create it in your mind. The only thing that is there, which is, I think, the reason why a lot of people love God of War and Tomb Raider and motion capture games, This Is Us, you know, games like that, is
Last
because
of Us,
The Last of Us. Yeah, I love that. Is because the actors are working off each other, and it's a connection. Now you get into AI, now you're not going to have that. Now are you?
No. Yeah, and I see a lot of actors coming out about AI saying that we do not condone our voice used. And I don't know if you've seen that recently.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Well, I got to be honest with you. Now, this isn't really AI, but it is, I guess, a form of AI. But I just went and saw Indiana Jones Saturday night at the IMAX.
How was it?
Have you seen it
yet? No, I've seen the four leading up, but not this one.
Yeah. It's very entertaining. Great movie. But I was like,
They de-age him, don't they?
Yeah, they de-aged him 40 years. And I already knew what had happened. They had stuntmen putting on these masks, Harrison Ford masks, full head mask, and then the computer generation. My son-in-law is a special visual effects producer, so I'm not going to knock that that profession.
Yeah,
but as far as an actor goes, I mean, you take that a little bit further, and you've got AI. You know, I mean, it's what is, you know, you're not going to need us anymore. And it was a little disturbing and a little. I was like very confused about how I felt about it. So
yeah, I
took
agree.
A little bit away from the movie for me, you know,
because you still can notice it a little bit, can't you?
Yeah, it looks like almost like you're watching a cartoon, like, or a video game, you know. And there's nothing.
And sometimes
wrong
it doesn't really work in the context of what we're watching, but and you just think, why can't he just be old? Why can't we embrace? Although
they were going back, weren't they?
Yeah, so it was a bit different. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I don't know how else they could have done it, but.
It reminds me of the Will Smith movie. You know, have you seen the Will Smith movie where he plays against himself, but a younger version?
That's right. Yeah. That was weird too.
That was weird. That was really weird. Yeah. I still find it, a bit bizarre, but that might just be me.
See, that's what the strike's all about. We're trying to get these things ironed. It'll be perfectly fine if they work out an agreement to compensate everyone for it.
So talk to us about how you landed the role in God of War and what your expectations were with this game, what they told you, because this would have been years ago now. You would have probably landed that role 2015 2016.
I think it was around 2015. It was an audition I went in for. At the time, I went in and, like everyone else in Hollywood, auditioned for the role of Kratos. Of course.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. Wow. Everybody in Hollywood was auditioning for Kratos, you know?
Wow. And, I didn't know that. Yeah.
And so Chris really, he had a coup by getting that part.
He had competition.
I had no idea at the time, you know, what it was, because they have everything. It's like not really the script, not really the storyline, not really the characters' names. So, but once I was involved with the project, I knew, and from that, they reached back out to me a few months later and offered me the role of Brock, and read for the role of Brock. And I played around with it, and Matt Sofos and Richard Gobert, the writers, as well as Corey Barlog, you know, played with me a little bit as far as different types of voices. And anyway, we settled on one, and they offered me the job. So, yeah.
How long did it take you to find that voice and personality? Because it's...
We were still changing it up,
really,
after we had shot a bunch of stuff, and then we had to go back and redo it in the voiceover booth, because they decided, I don't know, it was first it was kind of like a, you know, a Norse, like a Viking type dialect, you know, and then they just started going a little more Americanizing it, or whatever, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
So anyway, it evolved.
Brock's quite he brings a lot of levity to certain scenarios, doesn't he? He's quite comical in many aspects, isn't he?
Well, these guys are brilliant writers, and And it also, as we got to know each other and they got to know me, and they, you know, because I say stupid colloquialisms like that all the time. Growing up in Texas, you know, we have a million of them. And so they would, like, fan-diddly-tastic or fan-fucking-tastic or, you know, stuff like that.
I know in the second game, I couldn't believe it was quit your nattering, you snake-sucking mummy milksops.
Yes, say that three times real fast, yeah.
When you see that line, what are you thinking? I mean, you're just probably loving life.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I'm not either. How many takes do I get?
So we will go into spoilers, guys. Just so if anyone hasn't played these games, I mean, you have to play them. They must play games. But I do want to get into some spoilers eventually. So just a warning to everyone watching. But before we get into that, what was the biggest difference for you, Rob, from the first game to the second? I'm curious, your process, the way you developed the character, what would you say was the biggest difference for you?
Well, I was more involved as far as in the story and, you know, traveling along with Kratos, you know, on his journey. And, you know, whereas in the first one, I was more, you know, they would come to me. And in this one, I was more involved. Our house or Sindri's house was the base camp, so to speak. As far as my character, they had a meeting with me. They called me up, Matt and Richard called me up before we ever started filming and said, you know, we want to talk to you about the game and everything. So we meet for breakfast and we're sitting there. They tell me for, I think it was like, I don't know, 3 hours, 2-3 hours. They tell me the whole story. Then they tell me I die. Oh, that's a spoiler. Just let the cat out of the bag.
Yeah, wow. And what's your reaction then? Does your heart sink a little bit or what?
Yeah, no, of course it did. And then I was out of a job, you know?
Yeah. Well, you look at it from that perspective, of course, but also...
that is where that famous quote from Corey says, if you want to rip the hearts out of the fans, you got to kill the family dog.
And family so dog.
That's what they told me in that meeting. And since then, it's become very well known, you know.
Yeah. So they told you that the first meeting before you even started shooting anything. So you knew right away.
Actually, what's funny is that they had already met with like Adam and Danielle and Christopher and you know, already told them what was happening. And Adam told me, he said, I just looked at him and I said, have you told Robert yet?
Yeah, right. Shit. So how do you respond to them when you say, can you say, oh guys, can we possibly do a rewrite down the line?
Well, no, I had to agree with them because you have to admit
it's a pivotal touching part, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very moving. And what I felt like though, because you know everybody would think automatically that the death scene is the most important scene and the most powerful. But for me, it was when I was with the Lady of the Lake and I find out that I had died before and I did not have part of my soul. And
I think that's the best scene in the game, the entire game, the spear scene.
Thank you. Thank you. But that to me, that was, it was really important. And I even told them when we were shooting it, I wanted to take my time with that and really make sure we got that right. And they did. They're so caring. Those guys over there, at Sony PlayStation. They really love working with actors, and they give you the time to do what you need to do and make it work, you know.
That spear scene is such an incredible scene, very moving as well, very emotional. How did you tackle that scene? How did you prepare yourself for that one and working alongside Chris?
Well, like I would approach any role, is I had to have my backstory and thinking in regards to things that I have lost in my life that would be devastating to me. And when you internalize that and make that part of what you're trying to bring across in your character, then you can feel it. You can feel it strongly. So
I think it comes across in that scene. And it's so interesting that Brock's one of the only characters that can talk to Kratos like that. Yeah, he's almost lecturing him in a way, or he can. Yeah.
He's got balls.
But Kratos, he takes it because he's got so much respect for Brock, doesn't he?
Well, yeah. I mean, made all his weapons, you know. I've kept him alive for a while.
Well, there's that too, yeah.
Yeah, and then, right up till the time that Brock is killed, you know, I'm mouthing off, right? You know, right up to the moment, you know?
Yeah. I think you got a few more quips in just before the death scene, didn't you, as well? Yeah. So talk to us about that death scene, because that is it was out of nowhere for me. I couldn't believe it. And you've got almost some of the main cast all around you as you're dying in this scene. I'm just curious behind the scenes as well, what it looked like for you, who was there on set, how emotional it was.
Everyone was there. Yeah. Wow. Everyone, and they were very supportive. And Adam is, of course, everybody, Adam's, his heart was ripped out of him, you know. He gave such an amazing performance. Well, everyone did. But it was really easy for that to be real because of Adam, because of Danielle and Chris and Sonny. It was, we took our time with it. We did it several times, and I don't know how Adam survived, because he was bawling his eyes out, on almost every take. And my heart broke. Yeah. Yeah. It was easy. I just lay there and died.
You had the easy job.
And I don't think Richard Schiff realized the importance of what was going on. You know,
yeah.
It's bad name. What is?
Yeah, that must be so draining for Adam, doing take after take, just letting your heart, go like that.
He's a brilliant actor. He's a brilliant actor, and all of them, they were all nominated for BAFTAs. Him and Danielle, and And I think I feel like I'm partly responsible for that.
Well, you should have been nominated, Rob. If I'm the judge and jury, I think.
Oh well, that's sweet. That's sweet. Thank you.
But I think the problem they ran into the BAFTAs is that they can't nominate the entire game for every game.
we were nominated.
You were featured a lot, weren't you? Let's be
honest. Yeah. Wound up winning a lot too.
Yeah. Very pleased. I think that game won a lot of awards in the end. So, and then for the funeral scene, I'm curious, were you there for that scene? Because obviously you're not talking, but
there were parts of that where I was there, but no, there was things that I was not there for. Mm-hmm. I mean, because they don't want to pay me just to lay on the ground.
I know. That's what I mean. Yeah. I didn't think you were there, but
there, I mean, you know, they did shoot some stuff where I was laying there dead, but yeah, no. And plus Chris Judge didn't want to carry me anywhere.
I mean, he is a strong guy.
He's a strong guy, but he ain't that strong, man. He's deadlifting 220 pounds, you know, I mean, that's,
Yeah, I
wouldn't wish that on anybody.
No, it's, have you watched it back?
Oh yeah, yeah. No, that's what I love about it. It's like as soon as the game comes out, people are posting it all over YouTube, and you can watch the whole game like a movie. You know, it's
yeah. I uploaded a lot of your scenes in one little package, and I'll go through some of the comments in a second, but yeah, it's amazing.
I'm not very good playing video games. You know, I'm kind of from another generation. And so I get my kicks out of watching the play, on YouTube, you know, what do they call the playthrough, you know,
exactly.
And, cause I could never get there myself.
Yeah, yeah. You know, well, you don't have a PS5, I'm guessing, do you?
No, actually, I have a PS3. And I thought, hold on, I thought I was getting a PS5 when this came, was delivered from Santa Monica Studios. I still haven't opened it yet, but I don't think there's a PS5
in it. If you're holding it like that, I think I don't think there is one. Do you have this, Rob? You have this little thing.
Yeah, that's in there.
You got that? Yeah.
Yeah, that's in there. Yeah. Mjolnir.
Mjolnir, yeah. No, and I've also got I think you get the Kratos statue, the game.
Oh, you don't have one of these though, do you?
No, here we go.
Yeah, look at this little guy.
Oh, that's cool.
Isn't that cool?
Where'd you get that from?
A fan made it.
Wow.
I asked him if he'd... I had him make me three of them, and I gave them to my grandchildren. I put them in little glass boxes, and autographed the back of it, and I gave it to them. This guy's
fantastic.
Lieutenant Bricks on Instagram.
Nice.
His name's Tyler.
Yeah.
He said, thank you, Robert, thank you for bringing Brock to life over these last 5 years. I think he's mistaken. It's 10 years. what a performance and what a story. I hope you appreciate these models as much as I have. But
wow.
Thank you, Lieutenant Bricks. But yeah, no, I've got little things.
What else have you got on that shelf? I'm curious now.
What else have I got? Okay. Got that.
Oh, everybody, nice. The one. Pop vinyl. I didn't know that. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. You can get these.
The double pack.
I had Adam sign it for me, and I signed it.
Well, that's got to be worth something. I think so.
They sell these for about 60, 80 bucks, something like that. Then how about this one?
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's a throwback.
Yeah. Mini mates.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a collector's
item. I got lots of memorabilia up there.
Yeah. Do you end up picking up much from your films that you do over the years? Stealing anything? From your shows and films, yeah,
of course. I have the scripts from just about every movie I've ever made, and it's like Cujo. I was offered like I can't remember how much it was, $3,000 for the script that I have for it, and Yeah, it's just, and I'm like going, but I didn't. My wife's like going, don't sell that. You kept it all these years. You know, I've kept it like, 40 years? And it's in mint condition. That, Return of the Living Dead, I've got the original screenplays for that. It just, you know, that, as well as I'm looking at Future Man right here. I've got a thing. It's a kind of like the God of War
stuff.
This is Sony PlayStation gave these to me. Corey Barlog.
That's awesome. That's really cool. Yeah.
But I've got Future Man up here, and I've got my business card and a cartoon drawing that was used in the show. And so I had them framed and put up there with a picture of me as the character. So.
What's something that you're missing that you want in your study? Is there anything that you're thinking, I need this?
I need it.
Mm.
Mm. I don't want for a whole lot. I mean, you know, but because, you know, I did find something though that was really interesting, and it was on Etsy, and this guy in somewhere in England handmade these Christmas ornaments, and my wife put it up with her other Christmas ornaments, but it was Brock's head.
Wow.
And it's really good. It's hand carved and hand painted.
To hang it off the tree. Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, and I don't ask these people to give me this. I buy this stuff so that, you know, because they're artists just like me, you know, and they need to be paid for their work. And I have people say, oh no, we'll, you know, you can have that. We'll want to give it to you. And I'm going, no, you
With your fan interactions, what's that like when they come up to you and talk about Brock? What do they usually say?
Oh, they similar to what you did, that it, you know, the scenes that meant the most to them, or sometime they have their own personal experiences of losses that they've had you know, it's touching. You've got the people that just love me because I curse and say funny things, you know. But I was just at a convention down in San Diego. Yeah, that's one thing I'd like to say. Is there any conventions in Australia?
Oh, yeah, there is, and we need to get you down. I'm gonna have a word to them, because
can you talk to somebody?
Yeah, I will.
I don't get invited to nearly enough conventions.
Yeah,
I got one. I did the one in San Diego. I've got one up in Sacramento I'm doing in September, and and I'm right now in the process of finding all of these on eBay that I can to buy, so that I can
sign them and
sign them and give them out at conventions, you know. I even reached out to Funko Pop, and they said, no, we don't make those anymore.
I'd be curious to know how many are in the wild or something like that. I know that they are a collector's item. There wouldn't be, I don't know how many they would have done for something like that.
I don't know. They're cool though. I mean, come on, man. You have a little character made out of you, you know. I can't imagine
that feeling of your character having the, you know, something like that. It must be a bit surreal, really. Figure. An action figure, exactly.
Funko Pop.
Well, you know you've made it when they've got you on.
Yeah, you know, and then it's you know, the only bad thing about it is I don't really have that many cosplayers that do Brock, you know, because nobody wants to get painted blue.
Why not Avatar? Everyone does it for Avatar. Why not Brock?
Shave your head and get down on your knees and walk around on your.
Yeah, it is a tough one, isn't it? That was another
interesting thing when we're filming motion capture, is whenever we're filming, you know, because we're supposed to be dwarfs, and Kratos is so huge, they would put they would walk behind Chris Judge with a pole with Kratos's face on it and walk behind him. So that's where you would look whenever for your eye line when you're talking to Kratos, me and Sindri. And then our faces were on our chest, so Chris would look down at those. So
you're never looking into his face. That's tough.
Yeah, that is very
tough. That's really tough.
Yeah.
I don't think people realize.
Unless you're sitting at the table or, you know.
Yeah.
There's times when you could do, you know, interact eye to eye. But, but Chris is he's already so tall and he's just one hunk of a man, you know.
But he's a bit he's a softie in real life, isn't he?
Oh, he's a sweetheart. I love Chris Judge. He's a genuine human being, man. He's a, he's a sweetheart. Yeah.
He's a real deal, isn't he? When it comes to acting, I mean, he puts on a hell of a performance in this game.
Oh yeah. Yeah. He deserves all the accolades he gets and him and I know Danielle Vasudi works very hard as well, and she pours her heart, and so there'll be times when tears are streaming, her makeup's coming running down her face, and then you got the dots all over, so I think it messes up the dots,
you ever find yourself crying during this shoot? Did you ever find yourself getting really emotional and tearing up at all? Or
well, yeah, like, there were a few times, but not, I mean, Brock's, he might get sad, but I never felt the need to cry. I cried after I died and I was finished and I knew that it was over.
As in Robert cried, not Brock. Yeah.
Robert.
Yeah, I would have cried too. Did you all just embrace and hug after that scene?
A lot of hugging.
Yeah, I can imagine.
With everyone, because it's like you get really connected with all the crew and the, everyone involved, the engineers. And one thing that a lot of people don't realize, and I still didn't realize it or even think about it so much, but you're in there and you're performing in a volume, this big empty space. And then you've got over on one wall, you've got a lot of people on computers that are working on, what you're doing. And then you've got other people that are watching you on a live feed from their offices and their stations throughout the building.
Wow.
And so I got reminded of it one time whenever I was like, I said, where's Richard at? I haven't seen Richard in a few days. And I was like, well, he should be here. And all of a sudden this voice comes out over and he goes, I'm right here, Robert. And that just reminded me, there's 300 people watching.
That's a bit daunting. I'd be a bit nervous, but as you said, you don't get nervous, do you?
Oh no. You don't think about it, but And that's when it hit me again. Because I knew it, but you forget about it,
Yeah. Talk to me about the relationship with you and Adam over the years and how that's evolved and maybe translated into the game.
Oh, Adam. Adam and I are very, we get along extremely well together. And he's got such a kind heart. And, he's such a beautiful human being that it's easy. It's easy to be friends with him. It's easy to work with him. He's a wonderful actor. As far as he teaches acting as well. And I think at one point, you know, that same thing that I just showed you,
the
Jotnar edition thing.
Yeah.
We were doing something somewhere, and Adam wanted everybody to sign it, and he wanted to auction it off for charity. And so he did, and it was on Twitter. There's some guy who, I can't remember who he is, but the thing brought $10 million for charity. And I was blown away.
Oh, my God. That's unbelievable.
Yeah. And I went to Adam right before his acting class that he teaches one night and signed it for him. I was on my way. Actually, Danielle had a premiere of her film, Song of the Valkyrie. Alistair and I went, and it was wonderful. Yeah. So anyway, Adam couldn't go because he was teaching his acting class. So I stopped by and autographed. But Adam is a sweetheart. We talk often, outside. We call each other and stuff.
I'm speaking to him soon. Is there anything you want me to pass on to him?
You tell him, call me. Hadn't heard from him in a while.
Speaking of Alistair Duncan, he's an integral part of this game. How does it work with him? Because he's obviously just ahead in the game, but I'm guessing he's just sitting there.
He's there
normally,
all the time.
Just working normally? Is he just in the suit like everyone else?
He's not walking along on Chris's hip, you know, doing this number. No, they have they've got a rubber head. It's Mimir. We pass that around and stuff and talk. But Alistair's there, you hear that voice coming. he'll be right off the edge of the playing area, and
because I love the riddle that he gets the riddle after your demise. I find that quite beautiful, that whole thing.
It was I'm telling you, man, these writers,
they're unbelievable, aren't they?
Yeah, they deserve a lot more credit than anyone, they really do.
It's a team effort, but obviously we know now that Odin is Tyr the whole time. I'm wondering, because you knew that the whole time you're portraying the character, you had that in the back of your mind, and obviously Brock is a bit sus on him the whole time. What? How do you approach that as an actor? Do you keep that in the back of your mind as you're delivering these lines? Just curious.
No, because the way I approached it was Brock was kind of jealous of the attention that he was getting. And, and then whenever I'm cooking and he comes along and he cooks something that's better than what I cooked, but I, don't want to admit he puts vegetables in it,
Oh, vegetables, yeah.
but I approached it as kind of envious and of him with it. Because he's this new entity that has been brought in, and everyone's accepted him and welcomed him with open arms. And I'm like feeling like maybe I'm being not given enough attention to. So. Which is always the case with me.
Oh, mate, it is such a spectacular performance. Those games are going to live on when you and me are both gone.
I hope so. I hope so.
I'm going to have to replay it now, I think. It's been.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that was left out. One of my favorite scenes, whenever I finally got to see it all in the playthrough, was I reached out to Eric, you know, the director, Eric Williams. And asked him, what happened to the scene with me cooking I was washing dishes in the kitchen, and all I had on was a little apron and my butt sticking, my little blue butt sticking out.
They cut it.
They cut it.
Oh, Eric, come on. Oh, that's hilarious.
And I was giving it a little bounce, and you know.
Oh, what was the reason?
Why would you lose that?
Yeah, that's so funny.
They've got to dig up and probably use later, you know, like
that's so funny,
Uber or something. You know,
I can imagine it now. It would work so well. Did you ever ask him why?
He just said they didn't. They decided they didn't need that. Good. You know.
I guess he knows better. He's the director. Yeah. I think he did all right in the end, so we'll give him a pass.
They just didn't like the way my butt came out in the artist rendering or something, or maybe.
I think you gave it too much of a jiggle, Rob.
I gave it.
You gave it too much. You got to be a bit more subtle next time.
Absolutely.
Man. So I just wanted to read out quickly a few of these messages. So I upload the best scenes of Brock on YouTube. Uh-huh. Hundreds of thousands of views, and the comments are just, if you ever want to get a pick me up, Rob, just go to this video. I mean, so many nice comments. Watching these videos is heartbreaking. I can't stop crying. What an amazing man, extraordinary vocabulary. R.I.P. Brock, we did it.
An extraordinary vocabulary.
You like that? The saddest part,
sweet Nana's nethers.
Mate, I was watching a cameo that you did for someone. God, it was funny.
Oh, really? I love doing those cameos. God, they're funny. I don't get to do enough of those either.
Everyone, make sure you get a cameo from Rob after this. It's so funny.
I really put my heart into it. I really got to think about it. Which one was you watching?
You were saying something about the Nana's nethers and the old fucker. The old fucker.
Yeah. Oh, the old fucker. Yeah.
So good. May this weapon strike true. May it be wielded with wisdom. May it be put down when its job is done. Rest in peace, Brock, the bravest blacksmith and the craziest dwarf to ever live.
Oh, thank you. I get a request for that one on Cameo a lot to bless something, or you know. So I
gotta say, my girlfriend the other day was watching New Girl, and I was shocked to see your mug pop up. God, it was a funny scene.
I did like 3 or 4 episodes on the show. And Lamorne Morris is the actor.
Yes, that's it. Yeah.
Yeah, it was so fun doing that. And the director kind of let us riff and just kind of, and so like parts of that, there was a lot more that they didn't use that came out. I mean, it was like, what was it I said to him? It's like, can I take a picture of you eating a popsicle?
Yeah.
Then we changed it, and I was going, make that a fudgesicle.
Oh, that's so good.
No, they liked it so much, they had me come back for several, a few more episodes. And it was a lot of fun working on New Girl, because that show is, I get a lot of, comments from people, and I go, that has a lot of fans.
I know. So talking to me working with Tyler Perry on Ruthless, that must be a bit of a dream job, I'm guessing.
I've been working for Tyler for 7 years now. I was on another series for him called Too Close to Home, and I play, it was about this girl from Happy, Alabama, who went to Washington, D.C., has an affair with the president, and he has a heart attack while they're having sex in the Oval Office. It's real life stuff. And she comes back home to Happy Alabama, and I'm the sheriff of that little town. And anyway, we did a couple of seasons on it, and then Tyler went on to do some other stuff. But it was about a year later, he was getting his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And me and a good friend of mine, Brad Benedict, who was also on that show, we were out. He was over at the house, and he was saying something about going to see Tyler tomorrow and get his star on the Walk of Fame. And I'm like, well, you know what? I'll go with you. So we went, and Tyler sees me, hadn't seen me in almost a year. And he goes, you know what? I'm going to be calling you soon. And I'm like, well, please do. And sure enough, it was like about 2 weeks later, I get a call, and they offer me, they have a new show.
Wow.
That has a sheriff, that country sheriffs. And so I've been doing that show for 5 years. Yeah.
See, it pays to show your respect sometimes and do different things. You never know Yeah.
Well, you know, what's that old saying? Been in the right place at the right time. But I'm pretty sure that Tyler would have like thought of me eventually, right?
Yeah, oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, it just yeah. Come on, he plays God of War, doesn't he? He's a gamer.
I don't know.
You'd be surprised how many of these big time players play games. I mean,
exactly.
You'd probably be shocked how many people know of your performance. I was looking at your Instagram, Rob, and I came across this photo of a character called Moonshine Jack. Can you explain to me who this guy is? Moonshine Jack?
Moonshine Jack? I did that. That was a movie I did. It was called Demon Lake.
Demon Lake.
And the producers got crossways with each other during post-production, and so the movie never came out.
Oh. But
we filmed it in Tennessee, and if you look at my reel, there's little clips, you know, from it. But it was it was a great character. I lived back in the woods, and I made this moonshine, and I used the water from this lake, and come to find out the lake water had like some kind of a, ingredient in it that made people like go crazy and kill people. So it's kind of like a horror movie.
Also, you end up killing people.
No, not me. No. Anybody I'd sell the moonshine to.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess I didn't drink my own stuff.
Yeah.
that was fun. I was in I can't remember the name of the little town in Tennessee, but we were out on this lake, and they got all these cabins for all the actors and crew and stuff, and it was a fun summer. Yeah.
But we're never going to see it, sadly.
Never going to see it, cuz I mean, hell, that was 2012, I guess.
Yeah,
11 years, you're never going to see that movie.
Well, we've got the reels at least. And then Future Man, Seth Rogen's, talk to us about that one. That one's, I haven't seen it yet, but I've heard good things.
You've got to.
Yeah,
it's on Hulu.
Yeah,
it's the funniest show. I mean,
yeah.
That I did that, but it was like 2 years, two seasons. And I did that the first season between the two seasons for Tyler Perry, that first series, Too Close to Home. But it was a blast working with those guys, because I was originally brought on for two episodes, and it's about these time travelers who come back from the future to stop this guy from create. He's developing a cure for herpes, and it winds up being something that converts people into like half robot, kind of like Terminator, half robot.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and but the way that the professor developed the cure for herpes was through possum semen. So in the laboratory, they're jerking off possums.
That's ridiculous. Now you've sold me on the show now. That's brilliant. You've sold me on the show. Oh, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, I figured that premise might get you hooked. Yeah.
I don't know what when you read that.
I was originally asked to come and do two episodes, and once I started doing it, we got to having so much fun. I wound up doing 7 episodes.
Oh, really? Wow! Yeah,
the storyline all of a sudden started being kind of more in my.
Who direction. Do you play? Who do you play in this
I
one?
I play Detective Vincent Skarsgård.
And, oh, okay. is he a good detective or what?
Oh, no, he's horrible. No, you know Leslie Nielsen in The Naked Gun?
Oh, how can you? Yeah, great.
Yeah, in those movies. I guess maybe I might have been subconscious. I just saw something recently. Somebody posted something. I go, that sounds like Skarsgård. I must have been subconsciously channeling Leslie Nielsen when I was playing Skarsgård.
Oh, you sold me.
But it just came to me. It's like, well, one of everybody's favorite lines is, I'm always talking about my partner. My partner, Jorge Santiago, left a widow, belly swollen with child. People just thought that was so funny.
Oh, now I'm going to have to
watch that. It's also because I say it like a million times throughout the show.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Repetitive. Yeah. I love that. So you also co-wrote a country song, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Yeah.
Are you a musician at all? Are you a singer? Are you?
I sing country music. Yeah. Yeah. I wish I was a musician. I have a guitar, but I'm not any good at it. I would never get up in front of people and play.
No.
Yeah, but I've done concerts with, here in LA, I've done shows in Texas. I do a fundraiser usually once a year back in my hometown in Texas to help benefit it's a 100-year-old opera house in that little town. It's a Texas historical landmark. It's called the Grand Theater. So if any of your people out there are fans of old movie theaters or opera houses, you know, the vaudeville shows used to come through there. And we've spent the last, I don't know, 15, 20 years renovating it. And so I brought Paul Overstreet from Nashville. I brought, if you're a fan of country music, I've got a lot of
people
I know from Nashville that, David Frizzell, and Brad Benedict, that I worked with before many times. Anyway, and he sings also, and his lovely, better half, Ashley Rose, they come and they perform, but I had done a play, a world premiere play at the Ruskin Theater that was based off of 17 of Paul Overstreet's hit songs, and I became friends with Paul as he was there during the rehearsal process and everything, and he wrote songs like Forever and Ever, Amen, When You Say Nothing at All, She Thinks My Tractor's Sexy. She Only Loves Me for My Willie. you know, great country songs.
I haven't heard that one. That's an interesting one.
It's about Willie Nelson. What's wrong with you?
Oh, man? Sorry.
Come on.
Jeez, I gotta get my head out of the gutter.
But Paul called me up one Saturday, and he was in town from Nashville, and he said, "Hey, I'm over here at the Sunset Marquee." He goes, "You want to come over and let's write a country song?" And I said, "I'm there, man." So went over.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
we wrote this song called "I Just Called Her Baby" because I couldn't remember her name. And
okay.
It's about a guy who wakes up next to a girl and then they wind up being together and then she disappears on him. But, you know, he just called her baby. I just called her baby.
That's cool. Yeah.
I sang it actually in Ruthless. That's one of the things that Tyler Perry does to you. He will
make you sing.
Yep. Yeah. He is like, he'll do ad lib stuff. Like you finish a scene and like we were doing the show and he goes, "We're doing a scene." And I get through with it and he says, "Ask him if he likes country music." So I asked the guy, he's an FBI agent. I said, "So you like country music?" He goes, "Not particularly," you know, and he's ad libbing. And he goes, "Sing him a country song." So I had to come up with something. So I used the chorus from that song. And
did that make it into the show?
Yes.
Wow.
And Tyler did. Yeah, and fascinating. Paul made a little bit of money off of it. You know, I called him up. Hey, we're using your song on our song.
Wow. There you go.
He gives me more credit than I deserve.
Oh, okay. But
he's done it a few times, had me sing on the show. It's a lot of fun.
What do you contribute to your successful marriage of nearly 40 years, Rob?
It'll be 38 years, July 20th.
Yeah. Congratulations. And give me some tips for the future. What do you suggest? Find a
woman who is extremely patient, you know, and someone who will put up with, find a woman who you love, you have, who's your best friend. And the patient part really does help because, I mean, she's married to an actor and actors are not easiest people to be married.
Is she not in the business?
No, she was when I met her. We actually met doing an audition for a play.
Wow.
She's a corporate executive with she's a big way. She had a very responsible job and I'm very proud.
Unlike
me.
You're always unemployed every other month and then you're employed
every day.
So I guess, do you have any, as we wrap up here, do you have any advice for the creatives out there that you'd like to pass along for that you've learned over the years?
It's all this. It's pretty much the same. You've got to work at your craft, practice your craft, work at it on a daily basis. One of the things that I always tell young actors is, and I don't teach an acting class, but
have you ever thought about teaching? Because I think you'd be fantastic.
I had an acting school for a while, but I had everybody else teaching for me.
Okay.
You know, but like Dee Wallace, she taught acting classes at my acting studio. You know, the mother in E.T. and in Cujo.
She's
one of my best friends in the world.
Wow.
And she got into teaching. And Kim Darby, if you remember her from Better Off Dead and True Grit. Now she taught.
You know some people in this world, don't you? Some good friends.
Thank you. But what I tell young actors is, you know, you It's like a baseball player. You can't go into a game and hit home runs if you don't go to the batting cage. So, you know, you need to go to class. You need to work at your craft and keep your chops brushed up, you know?
Yeah.
Brilliant. And I would say that would be the same for writers, editors, filmmakers, you know, keep working at putting your projects together and how you can deliver a better product.
You know? And are you still learning about acting to this day?
Always. Yeah. Always. Yeah. And it gets, I think the more you live life, the more, or the easier it is, because you have more to pull from, you know?
Yeah.
And
more stories. Yeah.
More experiences, more.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for taking the time, Rob. It's been an absolute pleasure to chat with you I told you to go quick, didn't I?
Is it already an hour?
It's over an hour. I've kept you long. I'm sorry.
Well, you can edit this out and do whatever you need to do.
I can't edit you. You're too good. I want to keep it all in. Is there anything you wanted to say to the God of War fans, the fans of that franchise? Because I know a lot will be listening to this. Is there anything you wanted to say to them? And, you know, I know you've got a lot of gratitude for the role and the fans. And
I'm full of fucking gratitude, you know. I guess what the main thing I would like to say to everyone is thank you for allowing me into your hearts for the last 10 years. And I mean, we worked on the first game for 5 years, and then before it came out. So, and then the second game was like 4 years. So
yeah,
it's been a good 10 year run. On this game,
and through the pandemic too.
Well, actually, I'll show you how much it means to me.
Wow. Well,
that's Brock.
Wow. When did you get that, Rob?
I had that done about 2 years ago.
Yeah. That's incredible.
Yeah,
that is awesome.
Yeah, because Brock's so close to my heart and has been part of my heart for so long, part of my life, that I said, yeah.
Man, that is really special. I didn't expect that. Yeah. Wow.
So to all the fans out there, Brock means as much to me and I'm so grateful that he means as much to you all.
Oh,
100%.
It's a shared bond, isn't it?
Yeah. And also the big thing is if there's any gaming conventions out there, tell them you want Brock and Sindri and the guys from God of War to come to your gaming convention. You know,
How many have you done since the game released?
I haven't done that. I've probably done maybe four.
What?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
I don't seek it out.
I'm perplexed.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I don't seek it out. So I don't know. I mean, I've got an agent for appearances like that, but you know.
Wow. Well, I'm going to speak to some Aussie guys, and because we need to get you down here, because I know you haven't been down here before, have you?
No, I would love to. One of my favorite shows is Outback Opal Hunters. You know, I mean,
Outback Opal Hunt. What's that? I don't know of that show. Outback Opal Hunters.
You're gonna have to look that one up. You go up to Cuba Petey and you look for some opals.
Oh,
that was my really bad Australian.
No, that trip. Was good. Is this a 2018? Also, it's only a recent show. Yeah. What do they do? What is it about?
It's about these people that it's like different groups of people that look for opals.
For treasures, yeah.
Yeah. Now up in the
Wow, that's so random that you watch that show.
I love that show.
Wow. There you go. I'm going to have to check that out too after I watch Future Man. Might be an interesting evening of TV.
There you go.
Thank you, Rob. I really appreciate it. Hey, before I let you go, can Brock say anything to Dan? Is that possible to round this one out?
Okay. All right. What would you like? Is there anything specific you would like me to say?
Can you just throw in the all fucker or something funny like that? Because that is just brings me to tears. So funny.
Well, if it isn't Dan the Man, the all fucker. I'll leave you with that one.
Oh, God. Thank you, mate.
Thank you so much, Dan.
Thank you, Rob. Really appreciate it. It really was a blast, man.